I'm looking at your huge blurb about who he is. There's, I saw there's a slide in your pack about, you know, some of your background. But as I mentioned on the meetup page, there's something like 70 books that he's written on agile and IT and systems and things like that. So I won't steal your thunder. The usual format we have is kind of just introduce the meetup. So as most of you know, it's every couple of weeks we meet up and kind of talk about data and data science. And then we move into a kind of food for thought piece. So this week, so this is just something to think about. Sorry, I'm not 100% prepared. Some of you might have seen this before. Yeah, Derek's laughing. It's pretty old school.
But it's still good.
Yeah, so this is called CRISP-DM. I think it came out of IBM. And it's kind of an approach for approaching data science problems or data analytics problems, or really data, working with data, I think. So if one kind of follows the cycle, starts off with this, you know, understanding the problem piece, which we've actually talked about in this meetup before when you hear presented about problem definition, solution measurement. And that, you know, keys it with data understanding. Then, as we're all probably quite familiar with, we've got your data preparation and modeling, which is an iterative cycle, which I'm sure we'll go into a lot more detail about. Evaluation, so again, that's around solution measurement. And, you know, again, there's a feedback to business understanding, but then deployment. And I think deployment's a really key part of this. And again, that's kind of why I chose this for today, because I think when we're talking about agile and, you know, adoption and all that, like, data science doesn't exist in a vacuum. It's, you know, it's got to actually have meaning and it's got to be used by, particularly if we're talking about business, you know, it's got to be used in enterprise, and it's a cycle. So, you know, these things are iterative and they improve and get maintained and reviewed and all that. So if you're not familiar with this, then it's probably worthwhile just having a think about how it applies to some of the work that you do. And, you know, it's kind of a good overall process to follow. If you are familiar with it, it's also maybe worth thinking about how it can be updated for how things work today. I don't, you know, it's pretty good, but I think there's also things about it that can change. So, it's difficult. I'll hand over now to Bhuvan. And as always, please feel free to ask questions and be interactive and have fun.
How much time do I have?
Probably around 40 minutes.
40 minutes.
Yeah, we usually like to have 10, 15 minutes at the end to just have a discussion or Q&A with us.
We can have a Q&A as I present as well, but I will try and stick to the time.
Yeah.
Given my Indian background, it is very important that I impress upon all of you that I can stick to time. First of all, my name is Bhuvan Unhelper. Method Science is my consulting company. But since August last year, I have moved to Sarasota in Florida. And the university I'm working with is University of South Florida in the Sarasota campus. And that's my email, and you're all absolutely welcome to contact me now or later. I've asked Anthony to be free to circulate this presentation right now in PDF format, please. and I'll tell you why. So, but yes, I look forward to chatting with you. I thought I'll put a little bit about myself. I came to Australia from India in 1986, that is 30 years ago, for a 10-month COBOL contract with Advance Bank. So if you are old enough, ladies are not, if you are old enough to know what's COBOL and if you are old enough to remember what's Advance Bank, that was in the Ice Age in Sydney. And somehow last year, through my work in Agile and in UML and in all the semi-academic work I did with UDS and Western Sydney University, I got this opportunity to go to Sarasota. Completely unknown place. I had to find out on Google where Sarasota is, and I kept occasionally confusing it with Saratoga, which is on the west coast of US. But I have had great time for the last almost 1 year, and it's summertime over there, and we are on vacation, and so I have continued not to shave, which is kind of, you know, my kids are throwing challenge at me saying, you can't look any more ugly, and I said, I will try. I have quite a few books which I enjoy writing, and the 18th book is the one from which I have a few slides. It is about to be submitted in another month or two. It's just 1 year late. My publisher is screaming his head off, but he's a nice man, Richard Henry, so he will accept my submission in another couple of months. And then there are a few interesting things. I'm a fellow of the Computer Society, and I'm very proud of that. That happened more than 10 years ago. So I've got only about 5 or 6 slides, and that's 5 or 6 more than what Anthony wanted me to bring. But I thought we will hook our conversation on these 5 or 6 slides. So we have some base to have a chat. And this is my first pitch. In fact, it is figure 1.1 in a book that might be about 500 pages when published. And as you can see here, I'm taking a approach to big data that is pitched at medium to large organizations. And having consulted with Westpac and Rabobank and AMP in other areas than big data, like Agile, like software modeling, like quality, I realized that the challenge of a large business seems to be quite different to the challenge of a technology research or analytical modeling. I spent about 6 years way back in the 1990s on 309 Kent Street, which was Dow Jones. And Dow Jones, Telerate at that time, was an analytical company. It still is. And competes with Reuters and all the wonderful bar charts and pie charts we see on which stock is going to go up and down, and ordinaries and oil and mining and gold and currency options. It was analytics. Black-Scholes, binomial, Monte Carlo. We had a wonderful mathematician, Shari Lindblom, her name was, sitting right next to us, who were all programmers and designers. And she used to dictate those mathematical models to us, which in today's big data world is analytics. It is becoming even more sophisticated. And one of my very dear friends, professor of decision science in University of South Florida, Professor Anurag Agarwal, who is a master in this area, says analytics have been around for thousands of years. The Silk Road and Galileo's invention in trying to find out that the ship is about to come And that's when he discovered that there is a curvature of Earth, I'm told. I don't know. And it was all related to finance and stock market. His argument, Professor Anurag Agarwal's argument, is that the big data world has changed analytics only by saying it has become fine granular. So, some of us who are cricket lovers, what a surprise. Something I miss in Sarasota is cricket. And it takes me a lot of time to explain to my American friends that it is not baseball. But as we know, all the bar charts and pie charts that came about, highly sophisticated reporting of One Day Internationals and T20s, have now gone right up to the wire in the sense that where the ball is likely to pitch, full length, short pitch, or proper length, or on which part of the stump, there is a certain percentage, confidence level of making that prediction, which experts knew in their head, but now computing technology and analytics make that possible. So analytics can become finer and finer and finer if supported by sophisticated technology. And if we search big data plus strategy on Uncle Google, because Uncle Google knows everything, it will come up with either analytics or technology. It will come up with decision science, statistical pages, or it will come up with Hadoop, HDFS, Spark these days, the entire distributed systems architecture. And a common way to explain that is no Google search ever fails. It may not come up with the most accurate answer, but it never ever fails. And one wonders why. And I'm not talking about network communication. Instead of one large server the size of this room, we have got 100,000 machines that are the size of a laptop, although that size is also pretty good. Incredible. So the technologies of Hadoop, I prefer to call them Hadoop ecosystem. And Doug Cuttings, who was a Yahoo engineer, and then he moved to Google and then did whatever he had to do on his own, came up with the basic fundamental technology of Hadoop. Both extremely crucial. But let's now try and talk to a business person, a banker, a decision maker, a top insurance director, airlines senior manager, or a administrator in a hospital. I find, and I have done some of this, they are neither interested in this or this. They are actually interested in their problems. We are not able to roster our nurses correctly. Or one plane load from Sydney to Melbourne goes half empty and the other one is overbooked. Those are the problems, not Black-Scholes binomial, neither Hadoop HDFS. So I thought, let me make a core contribution to the domain of big data by elevating it to a level where those who are running businesses find it attractive. And those who are interested in adopting find it slightly easier. And they are not people outside this room, they are all of us in some way, shape or form. So I thought, let us see what can be a holistic and a strategic approach to adopting big data, which will include this, which will include this, but which will enable a business to take rapid decisions, hopefully more accurate decisions and being able to change those decisions. And in the book I wrote on agile, I have argued that that is actually agile business, which is a lot more than Scrum or extreme programming. And so that's the marriage between agility and big data that I am putting forward. So this is all my work in the art of agile practice. That book has been quite popular in the US as well. And in fact, on my way back from here, I've been invited to go to Mexico. So I get off at LA and go to Mexico City and then go to Zaragoza, all on agile. I've been asked there not to talk too much about big data. So if I now look at the senior decision makers who are saying, okay, you have convinced me, I need an analytical solution, a suite of technologies that will help me achieve business agility. Now what? And this is not a new problem or a new question that a senior person, a senior decision maker with budget is asking. It happened when object-oriented technologies came on the scene in 1990s, when UML became a standard in early 2000s. Now I think it is becoming an ISO standard. And when the whole agile tsunami came about, people are saying, okay, you convinced us, now what next? And we have different ways of approaching. What I have done is put together, based on the previous process and standards experience, with what will be of value to an agile business from a big data perspective. I would say more than 50% of what I am presenting or writing or sharing applies to any kind of new technology or new approach. It doesn't have to be big data only. And the other half is big data specific. So the framework, it's funny, I was told a couple of years back by a couple of very senior researchers that these three words are now so over abused that I should not use them. Framework, strategies, and metrics. And I'm using all three, so I'm not listening. But if you guys have better words, I'm more than happy to accept them. So first of all, values. The business values. Again, when we list the words, they appear to be very generic. What's the big deal? But I have seen in practice that. And when agility, when we adopted agile over the last 2 years, we have done work with Rabobank right here. And we found that getting a group of people together and working through values, it's like mission and vision statement. You know, you take the mission and vision statement of Qantas and Westmead Hospital, and somehow they are the same. We'll look after our customers. Their customers are flying on a seat, here they are lying down in a bed. But the values are the same. So one wonders why. And I can tell you that there is a much more valuable psychological reason to arrive at it. Discussion for another time. But those values make sense. The key roles make sense. Who is a data scientist? And how is a data scientist different from a data analyst? And I want to work through that, because I can then present it to the person who says, here is $1 million or $10 million, and here is 1 year worth of time. Nothing agile in this, right? We have time, we have budget, and you show me some results, and these are your KPIs. So roles, I will take you through these decision box, these building blocks in a second. Although I am into agile, my whole approach has been composite agile method and strategy, CAM. And the argument there is that I need as much planning as agility in a real bank or hospital or airline anywhere in the world. And again, criticizing agile is a different topic. I do find immense value in it, but not the way, say, Scrum is used to produce solutions. Because there are so many principles of Scrum that I can't apply. If I have my business analyst sitting on Kent Street and my bunch of developers sitting in Bangalore or Philippines, does it work? Different topic. Parameters defining business, big data is as valuable to Westpac or Combank as it is to the coffee cart vendor or the coffee shop downstairs. Because that shop downstairs wants to know how many cups of coffee they will sell today, 15th of July in the morning. And they can't. They are using analytics in their brain, which is their experience, to figure out whether it will be 300 cups or 50 or 800. They can benefit with the data, the analytics. And, you know, Google, Uncle Google, has got the great server which can give them the answers they want. Why? Because it's cold in Sydney and it's not raining and there's a great meetup group on big data. And yesterday we finished, or day before we finished, you know, Origin, so we are drunk and now we are sober on Friday morning. I don't know. How many factors can we bring into that analytics? So cloud analytics is the big data offering to small business. And I have, in fact, a full chapter on it. Again, I'm not discussing too much on that. But the parameters that define a business and its starting point. And finally, agile practices, and then we have a manifesto, a strategy queue, and an adoption process.
Can I make a comment?
Yes.
I was just thinking as you were making that analogy about cricket and cricket analytics and all that, and analytics in the brain, which I guess you can kind of put under the umbrella of heuristics, so like rules of thumb. I was thinking when I learned how to bowl in cricket, they were just said pitch on a good length, six inches outside off, which are kind of two rules of thumb. But you know what the analytics brings, I guess, is that, as you said, the much finer grained, you know, actual, you can look at it, you've got the proof, and then you can actually focus down a lot more about it. Just like saying it's cold, so you can sell coffee. Well, there's a whole lot of other reasons as well. So.
Yeah, I'll give you a more businessy example. Faircast. Faircast has now been purchased by Microsoft for $110 million a few years back. A person took as much data he could, so terabytes and petabytes, to make prediction of fare, airline fare, from any city to any city, initially of course in the US, with 75 or 78% confidence. This is like, should you be bowling to me on good length? When I'm used to spin bowling, and it will be better to bounce me out. That is your analytics going on in your brain. So you've been coached in a certain way to bowl. But depending on who you are bowling to, and his background on whether he had a fight with his girlfriend previous night, and this is not a joke, because I have a bunch of students in Great Lakes Institute of Management in Chennai, which is based on Great Lakes of Canada. And a bunch of MBA students did a project on pricing a IPL player. And I said, if you guys get it right, offer me a job, please. Because these players, including our Australian players, are selling for $1 million plus. And one wonders, what's the strategy? What's the pricing going on? And that includes the entire profile of the player, the team, the town he comes from, the coaching he had, the coach he had, his family, and then weather, and then stock market, and then the way the economy is going, and then the way American elections are going, and the Australian elections, and you name it. If that can be brought into pricing, it is likely to be the experience that we are talking about. Because you are changing from ball to ball, depending on which way the wind is blowing, literally. So, finer granularity of decision making. To complete the Faircast story, that ability to predict the price of an air ticket, because you and I, in our common sense, think that the earlier I buy the ticket, the cheaper it will be. And that was precisely what this person thought when he started asking people sitting around him. And he found that there was very little correlation between time and price of ticket. In fact, some of them who purchased the previous day or across the counter got it cheaper than someone who purchased 3 months ago. So he built that Faircast algorithm, and he promised to return money back to you if his prediction was wrong. And he could do that because his prediction had a confidence level of whatever 70%+. I can go up to the casino. If I have a chance of winning 70%, I'm ready to lose 30%. I'm not suggesting you do that. Now, this is my core contribution, and you know, ultimately this, it is the challenge of my publisher how to put this in the book. And there are various thought processes that will go on the back room where at least we get more than just A4, maybe a little bit more than A4. And of course, on the website, and you know, anybody who buys the book can download it for free. And, you know, all of you don't have to buy the book because you are getting it for free today, right? So, here is. Let me take you through just the building blocks, and then we will, you know, open up to questions because I do want to answer as many questions as I can. But in the previous slide, I showed the value, the roles, the building blocks, the inputs and outputs, the conditions or parameters for business, the agile practices, and the big data manifesto, and the strategy cube, and the adoption process, 12-lane adoption process. But look at this, what is happening here? A SWOT analysis, which we all know, in terms of the business's position with respect to big data. The 4 V's, so 3 V's+1. So data and technology considerations. We know that big data is characterized by high volume, high velocity, and you know, my GPS navigation system or my phone is collecting and submitting data to who knows where my data is going, but every move of mine is tracked. And I've given up. There's no privacy. I might as well get some value out of it. So velocity, and one transatlantic or trans-Pacific line generates 1 petabyte, 1,000 terabytes of data. And I don't know, this stats is for Boeing, so I'm assuming that for an A380 it might be even more. So this is the speed with which data is generated, 1 petabyte within 14 to 16 hours of a flight. And variety. So we are talking about text analytics, wherein we are seeing all the comments that all of us posted on TripAdvisor for, you know, ridges in wherever it is, needs to be analyzed. And you are saying is great, 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 and I'm saying not bad, not bad, not bad. But the sentiments are similar, unless I say it's really bad. And we don't have rows and columns nicely sitting over there in a relational structure to analyze this. So we're going to pick all the TripAdvisor comments and drop them in MongoDB, which is a NoSQL database, another topic for another discussion, not only SQL, structured query language. And then the veracity of data. So volume, velocity, variety, structured and unstructured, including videos. Like, you know, once upon a time, betting on cricket was something like, will Steve Waugh smile in the next over? I'll put $10 or 10 rupees on it. Funny kind of betting. But is there a relationship between Mr. Obama giving a smile in a 3-minute speech or a half smile and something happening in Iraq or Afghanistan? Big data will analyze that. There is a very, very well-read book by James Ricard, The Death of Money. And I do recommend you have a look at it. And it's in fact $2 on Kindle. Death of Money by James Ricard. he correlated and proved the price of puts, and you know, put against calls, of American and United 2 days before 9/11. And his book, Death of Money, although it's all about wealth and money, is actually talking about this correlation and how he was then hired by CIA on a full-time basis to come up with algorithms for future correlations between two otherwise unknown entities, stock market and the disaster. And in his book he has documented how he was successfully able to predict the London tube bombings, and it was like few hours before they happened, he said something is happening, and he documented that in his book. So we have got opportunity to look at not just unstructured text data, but audio, video, and sensor machine generated data. And that's all over here. And then use cases for that, the whole Hadoop ecosystem. Then we are focused on analytics and visualization. And visualization, as you know, is changing every day. So there is a half chance in a few years' time we will have this entire meetup group sitting here, right here, and none of us are physically here. And that's already happening. You know, Professor Anurag is actually in Seoul, Korea, and he said, I'll show you a protest march on the street of Seoul. And the protesters in their hundreds are walking, and cars and buses are going through them because they are all holographic. So visualization has to go, will be going to that level where I press my watch and whatever analytics I want are available. So that's where I'm focusing. You know, the stock standard, descriptive, predictive and prescriptive analytics. And then I have added a couple of more are over here. User experience, before time T0 and after time T1, when a user comes in contact with the business. Here I have got enterprise architecture and organizational capability. So technologies, economy, processes, that is business processes, TES and social people. And the people bit, sorry, and to complete this building block I have got SMAC stack, because that is crucial. Social, mobile, analytics and cloud, SMAC stack, technology stack. It's a now quite a popular acronym, SMAC. Here I'm focusing on people and upskilling. And if you look at McKinsey report, Gartner reports on big data, they're all predicting severe shortage of data inputs, data skills, data science, data analytics, big data technology. So I've taken the CPIA framework, skills framework for information age. And you can Google CPIA and you'll find that CPI has a 7-level framework on how a person can mature in a set of skills. And they have 92 skills, which don't include big data skills. But I'm saying, hey, I'm making core contribution. So I'm adding 6 to 8 skills, completely unofficial right now. But I'm acknowledging that the 7-level framework, you know, you follow and then you do and then you learn and adopt and then you help others do it and then you envision and so on. So that's my building block for big data adoption. I'll quickly show you the details of this particular cube over here. So this is my, I mentioned about social, mobile, analytics and cloud and NoSQL, and then here various kind of analytics, and then enterprise architecture mapping. So you know, the 6 elements of the Zachman framework, what, why, when, where, how, who, together with various elements of the of business. So we go back, not finishing yet. And so this is where I will stop talking. I have a thought that this framework should also be, will be adopted in an iterative manner. And therefore, one way of looking at it, and I've given it a lot of thought, and Suresh can do more research on this, is if I look at the framework like this, instead of like on a two dimension, then it provides me with opportunity for three or four iterations every quarterly. Let's say we are given 1 year, then every quarter what should we be doing needs to go in a circle around this, which gives me an idea of, you know, what should be done first, then what should be, you know, the data and technology, then analytics and visualization, then correlating to the technology, the business processes and DBM, and then upskilling people, providing them training and so on. So that is my take on big data framework for agile business, BDFAB, as I have acronymed it. And that is meant to help medium to large businesses in particular to adopt big data. Okay, so that, oh, you're clapping, I'm finished, I can go. This was supposed to happen on this slide.
We're just moving on.
You're very kind, but now I would like to do two things, answer your questions, and more than welcome if you find the holes in this, you know, oh, you forgot that, Google, you know, what happened there? So, yeah, yes, sir.
Yeah, and there's a lot of food for thought there. I'm kind of really interested in, I suppose, it's some of the bigger technology companies, the Googles of the world, which kind of have this, is kind of in their blood, it's sort of systemic in what they do. Yeah. But my experience in working in some of the older school companies is that they're really early in the kind of adoption of big data, and there's a lot of noise around we need kind of data scientists or whatever, whereas in fact the skill set they probably need is somebody who is strategically very well-minded and able to play a bit with the data to do that. So I suppose the question is, I mean, have you seen this work for large companies, and what, how is that actually worked?
Yeah, more than two parts to the answer. I haven't seen this actually finished in.
Yeah.
It is being adopted, it is being tried. And in fact, in a little cell in Westpac, and that's where Hyder and I came to know, Anthony, our contact in between, they were experimenting with big data, but they were experimenting only here.
Yeah.
Not even analytics, they were straight installing a single node Hadoop or a multi-node Hadoop and experimenting with that.
Yeah.
I am very keen to see all of this actually, you know, not just paper. So this was experimentation.
Yeah.
And my methodology for research is also experimentation. And Suresh is one of the key researchers who is going deeper into this. So we have stepped through and we have improved on the holes that we found, like use cases, for example. I thought there is no place for UML type use cases. But the term use cases is quite commonly used in the big data space, where it is describing the scenarios for various business processes. So we have included that over here. Even here I got processes as one of the key aspects of my enterprise architecture, correlating to my enterprise architecture. I am flying out to Melbourne for about 5 days later in the month to work with another friend of mine to see the validation of this through at least one government agency, because it's recording, I'm not mentioning the name, but offline I can tell you what that thing is. So, I haven't seen this fully applied right now, I'm not too worried about it. I am presenting this as a research-based, experimented framework, so the methodology will continue to be experimental, and then you are welcome to help me out from there. That's what meetup groups are. Three places where it will be used or is being applied. One is right here in Australia, another is India. I spent 5 weeks there before coming here early in June. And a couple of organizations, large educational organizations are interested in applying, and to the US. In the US, there is a company called WristWatch, and they don't mind if I mention their name. And RiskWatch is very keen. They have risk management products, like business risk management, and they are keeping experimenting with this. Did I finish too early? I would love to have your thoughts. As you notice, I probably talk about data science as such only when we talk about the 4 week, the 3 week plus one. I haven't gone into any detailed analytical models or technology. There is a lot that is there. Perhaps some of you know more than I do, and there's a little bit that I know about as well. But I've kept that out of the current discussion. If you have a question around that, I will be more than happy to try and answer.
I think part of the silence in the room is you're describing the tip of a massively huge iceberg here. You know, I'm sure that for each one of these little cells, we could go off and have a 3 hour conversation. And if anything, I think my takeaway from this is, you know, whatever our personal narrow backgrounds might be in sort of either data engineering or algorithms or whatever, is to really expand that horizon and go, wow, there's a much larger ecosystem that we're playing in than we might have realized. And I think one of the things that you're touching on very strongly is the social aspects of, you know, how do we socialize this stuff throughout organizations? How do we have a conversation that can span from, you know, the Sophia level one of a person at the coalface all the way through to a C-suite? And that's occurring more and more in the conversations now in big data, is how do we actually have a conversation that can go across that stack and across the breadth of the business?
Yes. And I have actually taken some input from CMM to see if I can modify CMM capability maturity model to apply to big data maturity. And it has been applied in environment, you know, green IT. It has been applied in so many other areas, and it's a great model and well established, well understood. So I am trying to see if we can put a CMM equivalent, fully acknowledging CMM but modifying it. And in my book, in fact, I was yesterday working on one of the tables in that book where I have got the 5 levels of CMM, and then I have got 3 columns: individual, organization, and industry. And when it comes to big data maturity, you and I, as an individual, need to pick up skills in Python or skills in R or Tableau or NoSQL, and we are moving up the skills ladder. But at a organizational level, those skills are necessary to have, but definitely not sufficient. So we are going to need people who are able to correlate analytics embedded in business processes. You know, how much of cash should I put in that ATM next to circular key today is a banker's decision. So that decision making needs to be related to the nitty-gritty of R and, you know, from Tableau. I did a small course in Tableau and I found it a highly sophisticated Excel, which is nice to have. Excel itself, you can program a whole solution in Excel these days. It's pretty good. So, yes, I appreciate your feedback that one of the takeaways from an exercise, this has been going on for 2 years now. And so every nitty-gritty bit here is like a cog in a wheel, and is necessary but needs to be seen holistically. And that is where perhaps in earlier attempts at technology adoption, we didn't do, we the humanity, we the IT community didn't do enough. Because this either appears too fuzzy or too complex, or you know, a matrix for this is rather difficult to put, that's the third word I'm using. But when I showed this to a couple of my students in Sarasota, they said, "Sir, can we develop a mobile app for this?" And I said, "Well, this is Pokemon version 5. I mean, I'm finding very funny that in my home, my son, who is getting retired, he wouldn't get out of the bed till 1 in the afternoon. He's suddenly waking up in the morning and saying, I'm going for a morning walk, I'm taking the dog out. And I said, what happened? Then I realized something is happening out there. And that's Pokemon. So, I mean, I don't know whether this can be embedded in a mobile app, but perhaps the visualization aspect, perhaps a banker or an airline, decision maker, manager, can very easily make use of visualization to take decisions. And you and I are taking those decisions when we go, use our traffic or our, the train timetabling app, which I'm using quite heavily. It's making use of every data it can, linear data, I should say, to figure out when my train is going to appear on my platform. But if it has to make predictions whether this same train is going to appear on this platform at this time tomorrow, it's going to need a lot more than linear data. It's going to need weather data and, train traffic.
When businesses arrive, like when they have to make a business decision, especially the management level, they tend to rely more on their intuitions, their experience, and their logic than actually what technology or what the system are saying, especially at the high management level. Maybe just because of their, the position or the experience they have brought on, or maybe it's a human behavior aspect. So these models or these technologies do take consideration of those sort of human behaviors where, people tend to be in a denial mode just because they think, no, my experience says something else, or the model says something else.
Yeah, Alan Greenspan, way back, was asked how he takes decisions. Because sometimes some of his decisions were based on a cup of coffee that have affected billions of dollars. And he said, well, all I do is I remove the 6 zeros and then I take my decisions. So in the sense that, he removes 6 zeros from a figure and then decides whether, where this money should be moved. This is the Alan Greenspan topic. So I guess you are touching on a very crucial aspect, and there are some other slides where I had it, that there is the explicit and the tacit aspect of decision making. The explicit is the data, we say data speaks, and we say, so this is a data-driven enterprise. So all decisions are based on hard facts. Mm. And the data is saying, do something, and we have to do something. But have we incorporated in a model like this, and I have, the tacit element, which is the experience element that you are talking about. Now, if a decision maker says, that's it, I'm going to take decision based on what I feel is best, then there are stories that, airline pilots relying on their intuition have tried to land their airplanes on a Milky Way, because they are trying to land it upside down. That's the story I have heard. On the other hand, if you are relying entirely on data, and there have been major disasters because some thought it is centimeters and others were talking about inches. So we have to strike a balancing act between tacit and explicit knowledge. And we are talking about decision making based on insight, which is based on knowledge, which is based on information, which is based on data, which is based on observations. And all of this is big data. It is small data as well. But definitely in the big data space, it makes phenomenal amount of sense. The other aspect is the veracity, the fourth V over here. If you are given 10 data points and you need 99% accuracy, you can't have one data point go wrong. But if you are given 10 million data points and you are expected to have 99.9% accuracy, you can still have 10 data points going wrong. And there is no point in spending effort trying to cleanse the data in a big data domain where the records are billion rows. Right? So decision making by a senior decision maker has to balance between the explicit knowledge that data presents and the tacit knowledge that he or she carries in her head. In the past, with coarse granularity, the balance was towards tacit. Now with finer granularity, the balance is definitely towards explicit. But if it is entirely based on data, I think the decisions may go wrong.
Yes, sir. Another different question, but you said this is focused on medium and large enterprises. So for a small enterprise, are there aspects of this which would you think is still applied as a model?
Yes. But that is where we are calling it cloud analytics. And Professor Yi Chen Lan, Western Sydney University in Parramatta, I have already spent a couple of full research days with him, and we are spending more research days in the next month and a half. And his focus is on small and medium enterprises. There are 72,000 SMEs in Western Sydney region. In fact, Western Sydney region is the next largest economic sector in Australia after Sydney City, I'm told, even beyond Melbourne. So there are people who are trying to sell furniture, and there are people who are manufacturing wine bottles, and there are people who are trying to sell flowers. Although we believe that everything comes from China, but it doesn't. There are things that are happening here, right here in Western Sydney. How can they benefit from big data analytics? You know, like the coffee cart vendor downstairs. They don't care about NoSQL, and they have no idea about Hadoop. And they are not, they at the most will have a phone which has to give them a number. That's the explicit part. And then they have to decide based on the number. The number is saying 376 cups of coffee this morning, and then they have to decide based on their tacit knowledge. So cloud is the answer for small businesses. And we are working around big data analytics on the cloud. Large businesses are more interested in storage and, you know, security and so on, and less bother about capacity planning with the cloud. Small business knows, here is a website, here is www.google.coffee.whatever it is, in which I have registered, and they are going to, I have set my parameters, and they are going to give me an answer about how many cups of coffee tomorrow morning. That's the extent to which small business will go, pay as you go. And they, who knows?
Do you think their own data as well as not?
Yes, you will need it. Yeah. Where is it? You know, this conditions is going to be what a small business needs to feed into the website that they will use. You know, size of business and some factors that they have to feed in. And it's exactly like going to a doctor, you know. You want good diagnosis, then you have to expose certain parts of your body. My daughter is a doctor, so we have a bit of a joke on that. You know, privacy in IT world, it's so important. Well, it is important, but there are times when you have to reveal certain things to get certain value. How much can a small business reveal? I think small business is happy to reveal everything. They don't care. They get that information that they are looking for. So yes, it is important. And we are working on that even in this market. Cloud analysis. Where they don't even know. It's like some of the traders here, you know, financial market traders. And I used to visit their offices, and they used to, you know, have a tie, and you know, they'll be shouting and screaming, but they don't know what's a black show. They do know what the black show is, but how the formula is calculated, they don't know. So in that sense, a small business doesn't care how the analytics provide, so long as the confidence level is the reliability. All right, I am an Indian and I am managing my time well. By the way, that's a joke, I am an Australian as well. So thank you for the opportunity, please stay in touch, and thanks to Anthony for inviting me. Once again, thank you. Still around, I have nothing else to do rest of the day in case you want to have a chat.